I don't think there is any such thing as financially free. And I think it's a good way to package things, because if you actually look at the term financially free, it's Googled over 33 million times, which means people are very desperate to look for the quickest route from A to B, which would be financially free. So when you say you help people to be financially free, what do you mean by financially free? I don't think you would be as successful as you've been if everything was bad. I mean, you've just bought a £3 million mansion in Buckinghamshire.
Yeah.
My education is quite low. I don't know anything about property.
Yeah.
So I want to leave my job in a month.
Okay.
So what does this packaging of deals look like? What's my first step?
Okay. First step, when you wake up in the morning, instead of going on Instagram and scrolling through, go on Rightmove.
All these conversations, they're not happening. What? Why do people make rent-to-rent sound so easy when it actually isn't? I'm going to keep it 100. I make $1,500 a month from my job in JD Sports. I've looked at Samuel Leeds. What is my next move to try and get involved in property? What would you say to that
person? I think that's a really good question. You know what? Rockefeller says, own nothing, can control everything.
Okay.
The biggest thing people ask me to prove, rather than like, what qualifications do you have to teach? Because I never went to university. Yeah. I failed in school.
Yeah,
I failed academically. Yeah, yeah. What people want to know more than anything is, who have you taught and what have they done?
Just because people are so curious. What was the whole thing with Alan Sugar? You did sit down with him. I think, did he come out and say, I don't know this guy? One thing I do love is, you're actually in the process of suing people.
Yeah.
And that is important.
I've been compensated already.
Yeah. And was that to do with the attachment to the soldier who committed suicide? Give you a bit of advice. I think you should just stop answering the trolls. Mr. Samuel Leeds, thanks for coming.
Great to be here. Thanks for having me.
I wanted to speak to you because I think a few things, really. I think that many things about you are misunderstood. And also, I like property myself. And I know that you've made a lot of people really successful. And I also know that we live in an era that sometimes negativity can override so much positivity, even though sometimes there's far more positivity. I don't think you would be as successful as you've been if everything was bad. I mean, you've just bought a £3 million mansion in Buckinghamshire.
Yeah.
You're involved in a development of a castle, which is worth £6.3 million.
Yeah, gross development value, yeah.
Yeah, been involved in over 400 property deals.
Yeah.
And the most interesting thing is you started at 17.
Yeah.
How did you manage to get involved in property at 17? Because when I was 17, what the hell was I doing? I was actually touring with Fundamental and Three of a Kind, but I definitely wasn't making what you were making, which was over £6,000 a month at 17.
Yeah, I mean, not quite. I was at 21. I was making £6,000 a month. I did start at 17.
Okay.
I went full time in property at 17, but it was tough. And you know, I left. I was working for my dad. Well, as soon as I left school.
Yep.
And I quit that to go full time into property after reading a few books.
Mm-hmm.
One was a book by Robert Kiyosaki.
Yeah.
Rich Dad Poor Dad. And I think I just felt like, you know what, I'm living at home with my mom. I was really. Had a real fire in my belly to be successful. And I thought, if I don't do it now, you know, when is a good time?
Yeah.
So, yeah.
So what was the first, at 17,
yeah.
So you read Rich Dad, Poor Dad.
Yeah.
And then how did you make your move from there?
So I read Rich Dad, Poor Dad actually when I was 16, when I was at school.
Yep.
And I also read Screw It, Let's Do It by Richard Branson. And I think for me, because I wasn't very good in school, I'm really, really bad in school.
Mm.
I sat on the special needs desk. You know, I've got ADHD, dyslexia. So looking at some of these guys like Richard Branson, who are very successful, but also bad in school, kind of inspired me.
Mm-hmm.
And I thought, well, hang on a minute. If these guys have done it, maybe there's something, you know, maybe I can be successful. Maybe I'm not a complete write-off. And when I left school, I went to a property seminar, like a property networking event.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, I felt completely out of place. I remember buying a suit for the event, which didn't fit me properly.
Mm.
And I was just like, man, I don't know. I felt totally out of place.
Were you the youngest there?
Oh, by a mile.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think probably the youngest there outside of me was probably 40 years old.
Did you go by yourself?
Yeah.
Because usually at that age, you want to bring someone like, oh, I'm not sure. And you just decided,
my girlfriend
care.
Dropped me off.
Oh.
Yeah, dropped me off and was like, oh, I'll pick you up, you know. And I was like, all right. And then I walked in and they were like, oh, it's open networking for the first hour. And I literally stood in the room next to a pillar.
Yeah.
Just hid for the first hour behind a pillar because I didn't want to talk to anybody. I didn't want anyone to ask me any questions because I felt really out of place. Mm-hmm. But then it was that seminar where they started talking about how you can finance deals. And some of the guys there actually took me seriously. Mm-hmm. I'm like, oh, yeah, you can just. And that was like a massive, for me, being at that program was.
They spoke to you like an adult.
Yeah. Mm. Not like how they spoke to me at school. They were just like, you know, hey, so what are you doing? You know, what are you wanting to do? And there's a guy there called Simon, who's a millionaire, who spent 45 minutes to me on the phone after the program. Mm-hmm. And I just thought, man, like, this is crazy that people actually believe that I can do this. Mm-hmm. And I think their belief in me kind of made me believe in myself a little bit more.
So then I take it you had no money at 17.
Well, I had a bit of paper and money.
Yeah, okay, what did that look like?
3,500.
Okay, so that's a decent amount for 17.
Oh yeah.
So you had £3,500 at 17.
Yeah.
And then what did you do with it to get involved into property?
Well, I put it on property training courses.
Oh, you spent it? And then what? So we're back at zero.
Back at zero, no, minus, because I spent it and I also went into overdraft and borrowed some money from my brother.
Yeah.
And again, my friends were like telling me I was an idiot, telling me I was being scammed. Ironically, they were going to university to study drama.
Okay.
Right?
Yeah.
So it's all right to go to uni to get a degree in drama.
Yeah.
But then for me to go to on these training programs, oh, it's a scam. Be careful. What are you doing?
Yeah.
4 years later, I'm financially free. Mm-hmm. They're a very dramatic McDonald's worker.
Yeah.
You know, literally. So it's the status quo, the whole way that we're programmed. Mm-hmm. I realised, actually, I don't have to get a good exam to be somebody.
Yeah. But then, as tangibly, how did you manage to go from minus zero to then being successful 6 years later?
Yeah.
So no money again.
Sure, okay.
The £3,000 gone.
Yeah.
How did you manage to get your first property or invest or do a property deal at 17?
So the first thing that I learned when I went on these training courses was don't worry about the money. Don't worry about how you're going to finance it. If you want to be successful in real estate, you just need to find good deals. If you can find good deals, you can then make money from that. You can package the deal and sell it on. You can find someone to finance it for you. You can joint venture on it. Mm. You can borrow the money, but just find good deals.
Okay.
That was what I was told. Now, this was around about 2008. Mm-hmm. And just before the recession. Mm-hmm. And the strategy at the time was to buy properties below market value, mm-hmm. buy them on a bridging loan, and then refinance them the same day.
The same day?
Yeah, and then when you refinance the property mm-hmm. up to 100% of the true market value, then pay off the bridging loan, mm-hmm. and you're left with a property which is completely 100% financed by the bank.
So are you saying you did that at 17?
Well, I couldn't do that at 17 because I couldn't buy a house because I'm too young.
Yeah.
But I learned how to do it.
Okay.
So I started finding deals and passing them on to other investors.
So explain to me what this first deal looked like. So you knew at 17 you couldn't buy a property. You couldn't take out a bridging loan. So did you convince someone to do it?
Well, to begin with, I would find leads and I would pass them on to investors and ask for £500. That's how I started at 17.
Yeah.
I bought my first house at 17.
Yeah.
And how I did that was because I was thinking, when I'm 18, then I'll buy my own house because I'm old enough. But then my mortgage broker said, you've got to be 21 to get a buy-to-let mortgage. I'm like, I'm not waiting 4 years. Mm. So I start thinking, well, what can I do? So I spoke to my brother and I said, hey, can you put a property in your name and can you be like a host for me?
This is when you were 18?
I was 17.
17?
Yeah.
Okay, so it was in his name?
Well, no, he couldn't either do it. He couldn't get the finance.
Okay.
So I'm banging my head off a brick wall.
Yeah.
My mom had remarried. My mom was married to a guy called Tim. We didn't get on that well at the time.
Okay.
But Tim kindly said, I won't give you any money, but I will be a host for you.
So the first property you bought was in your stepdad's name?
It was. Financed by basically this creative way that you could do back then.
Okay, so through getting deals and saving up 500, 500, 500, you managed to get a deposit?
No.
Okay.
I found a house, 21A Maryvale Road, mm-hmm. Bourneville, Birmingham, mm-hmm. B32DA.
Okay.
Right?
Yeah.
I found that house that was worth 120 and I agreed for them to sell it me at 100.
Okay.
I then got a bridging loan.
Not in your name, in Tim's name.
In Tim's name.
Okay.
Tim was the adult that hosted the property, but he didn't put a penny in.
Okay.
I then bought it for 100, mm-hmm. and on the same day that I bought it, refinanced it at 120.
With Tim doing it?
In Tim's name.
Yeah, everything was in Tim's name.
It was in Tim's name.
Okay.
But he didn't pay a penny.
He didn't pay a penny.
It was all financed, this creative way that I'd learned on this course.
So when you get the bridging loan, you don't need to have a deposit, you don't need
to... Well, you buy it. If the property was worth 120,
yeah,
I bought it for 100, but the bridging company gave me 100% of the purchase price because the value was higher.
Yeah.
And then I refinanced it same day, paid off the bridging loan.
And if you don't mind, how did Tim qualify for such a large loan?
It's not large.
Well, in terms of, was it a personal? Was he?
No, it was based on the value of the house.
100 grand.
Yeah, but the house is worth 120.
Okay, so the surveyor...
So that's only like 80% of the value of the house.
Yeah, so the surveyor came along and said, this is the, it's worth 120.
Yeah.
So the people that gave the finance
saw
that, what the surveyor said, and was like, no problem, because, okay.
Correct. But then,
because of the asset. If it went tits up, they could take the asset.
Correct.
Okay.
So that was how I got my first property. I'm like, okay, amazing. I then rented it out room by room.
Yeah.
Made £1,000 a month from that.
And again, with Tim?
Well, no. I just found the tenants myself on spareroom.co.uk. At this point in time, I literally spent about £1,500 just on fees, which I paid for out of the bits and bobs that I'd made.
Yeah.
So Tim hadn't given me any money. I'd financed it this way. But after that, the property went down in value.
Oh, no. Negative equity.
Well, kind of. Not quite negative equity, but it went down.
Okay.
And also... the mortgage lender went bust.
Oh,
so my second deal that was the same, structured the same, that my brother was going to finance, 3 days before it went through, it all went bust. The banks went bust. Mortgage Express went bust. And that whole strategy that I've just explained, you can't really do it anymore.
Okay.
Because they would say, if you buy it below market value, you change the value. Lenders got really tight. The reason for the recession in 2008 was because lenders were too lenient.
Yeah.
So I was tapping into that.
Mm-hmm.
But then lenders tightened up. I can't do the strategy anymore.
Yeah.
So that kind of left me high and dry.
So what was the new strategy?
Well, it took me a year to figure it out. I just banged my head off a brick wall for a year.
Okay.
Like, literally laughed at. You know, all my friends and family, they told me to not do it and to be careful. And I'm like, oh, see, you've got this property, but it's now gone down in value and the banks have gone bust. Go and get a proper job. Go and get a proper job. So that was like a year of hell for me.
Yeah. And what did you do during that year? Did you have any income?
Just this one house.
Okay. Where each room is let out.
Yeah.
Okay.
And that was about it. I did a little bit of deal sourcing and I managed a few properties for people. But it was a tough year.
Okay, so then when did you get back on your feet and then buy more property?
19.
And how many did you buy then?
6 houses, age 19.
So you bought 6 houses that were all in your name?
Well, the strategy that I used was a strategy called lease option agreement.
Okay, explain this.
That's when you buy a house,
but
you agree to pay for it later.
Okay, and how do you do that?
So let's say you're selling a house and you want £100,000 for it.
Yeah.
In fact, I'll give you the example. There's a guy called Steve.
Yeah.
This was in Bloxwich. On Cleveway Road, and Steve wanted to sell his house.
Mm-hmm.
He wanted to sell it for 85 grand, but it was only worth like 80, and there was a mortgage of 81. So he's basically got no equity
Nothing,
in it.
Yeah.
He bought it for 95, but it had fallen because of the crash.
Okay.
So I said to him, I'll buy it off you now. You're struggling to sell it because the times are tough. I'll buy it off you now for 81, but I'll pay you in 7 years' time.
Okay.
But if you sold it now, you wouldn't make any money anyway, because you'd have to use all the money to pay off the mortgage that you owe.
Okay.
So I'll take the debt off you, but you give me the house.
Okay, so essentially you're just taking the debt, but you haven't got the physical asset yet.
You've got the option to buy it.
Yeah.
So I had a restriction order put on the title deeds
that
said that I had the first option
to
buy that house anytime between now and 7 years for 81,000.
And what if he decided to pull and no longer sell?
He can't.
So that's it. It's basically a done deal.
He tried
deal.
To do that.
Did he try? Okay.
And he couldn't.
Okay. And then obviously it went up in value.
Yeah, a lot.
A lot.
A lot.
Okay. But then you don't do that anymore.
No, I still do that. I just did one last month.
Okay.
Still use the strategy. It's called a lease option agreement. Also, I benefited from the rent every month.
Yeah.
Because I take control of the property. Yeah. I've got the option to buy it.
Yep.
So I'm like, I don't own it. It's not in my name. Mm-hmm. But I got a you look on the title deeds, it's not owned by me, but I got control of it.
So essentially, the best people to benefit from that are ones that are desperate to sell?
Not necessarily. A lot of tired landlords, people that are in negative equity, yeah. or people that inherit the property and they don't need the money now.
So how do they, sorry to sound like a complete idiot around this, but how does that benefit them when they can just hold it? Is it because from when you do that lease agreement,
yep.
you are paying for the mortgage now,
yes.
but you just haven't actually bought it and the deed hasn't changed?
Yep.
Okay.
So he's got relief of the property.
Okay.
Yeah.
So you can still use it as a lease,
yeah.
and you just don't have the title as yet.
Correct.
Makes sense.
I do it now on land. So now okay. what I do these days
yeah.
is I buy land
yeah.
with an option.
Mm-hmm.
I then get planning permission on the land,
mm-hmm.
push the value up, mm-hmm. and then reassign it to somebody else and profit from the planning gain.
Makes sense. So by 19, you had 6 properties.
Well, and the first one, 7.
And the first one. And those yeah. were in your name.
Well, they're like, the first one was in my stepdad's name. So they're like in their lease options at this
yeah.
point. I had maybe one, I bought one. Age 19 in block switch, which I put as a residential in my name. But mostly I'm young. I'm like 19, 20. I can't be buying houses in my name, even if I had the money.
Oh, they're all leases at this point. So yeah, like they're 19, like leases. They're all leases. So when did all the titles of the 6 property go over to your name?
Some of them, it took 7 years.
Yeah?
Yeah.
But you were still obviously making money
yeah.
from them.
Well, you know what? Rockefeller says, own nothing can control everything.
Okay.
So in real estate, it's not about ownership. Mm-hmm. It's about controlling properties. A lot of the strategies that I've done and that I teach, packaging and selling deals, lease option agreements, rent to rents, you're not actually buying anything. You're taking control of it and you're profiting from it.
Mm.
And that's the smart way to make money in real estate.
Okay, so then you've also got the biggest property training program
yeah.
in the UK.
Yeah.
So then how did you start that off?
Well, when I became financially free at 21, I was in a good place financially.
Yeah.
You know, I got kind of judged by my church and stuff, and people were like, a lot of my community was saying, to earn more than you need is greed.
Mm.
And there's this whole concept around, you know, you've got enough. And if you buy more houses, you're taking away from the poor. And there was this whole mindset around, you know, my family, my church. So I took a few years out.
What religion were you?
Christian.
Yeah, what denomination?
Oh man, I'm not really any denomination. I mean, the church I was at.
That's where you were at.
Oh, it was like ex-brethren.
Oh, Mormon.
No, not Mormon. Like, just sort of like old school, strict, ex-brethren. It's a little bit like Church of England, but a bit kind of stricter.
Oh, yeah, because I grew up in the church,
okay.
really strict, and they had the same... Yeah.
The same mindset.
Exactly the same
right.
mindset.
Where poverty is worn like a badge of honour, right?
Well, I think what it is, and people will dislike me for saying this, but I think a lot of religion, or why people join religions, is because they're either struggling with something or they are in a destitute position, so they need something to hang on to. And if people in the church... encourage that you don't need wealth, it makes them feel better about their current situation if they are impoverished at that time. So I think this whole concept of in the Bible, it says, do not build your riches here on earth because there'll be something better in heaven. It's my life is shit now, but don't worry, there's something waiting for me, which I don't necessarily agree with. So I understand when you said the church had this negative sort of,
yeah.
you shouldn't expand your wealth on earth because yeah. it's supposed to be in heaven.
Yeah, not just my church. I think generally in Britain, I mean, in America, it's a little different. In America, if you see someone driving a Ferrari, they'll clap, right?
Yeah.
They'll go over, they'll be like, what do you do for a living, man? Cool car. In Britain, it's just, jerk.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So the whole mentality, not just in religion or church, but the whole mentality around wealth and, you know, so my friends, when I first started out, were a bit skeptical. Some of them cheered me on, but when you start, it's lonely at the top. And when you start succeeding, people want you to win, but just not more than them.
Yeah.
So as soon as you, you know, when I was like 20, 21, I was doing pretty well.
Yeah.
I wasn't like a millionaire, but mm. I was doing pretty well.
Mm-hmm. Oh, and that's when you were making like 6,000,
yeah,
7,000
yeah.
a month.
Yeah, about 6,000, 7,000 pounds a month.
Okay.
I actually had about a million pounds worth of property under my control.
Yeah.
but that doesn't include the debt and the.
Yeah, so I was doing okay. Yeah, yeah.
You know, my church, you know, really, I felt really judged and misunderstood by my church and other people. And because I was quite a religious person, you know, I was very involved in my church. And, you know, I went, I decided to take a few years out. I studied Bible, I went to Bible college, I studied theology.
Okay.
And my dissertation, I decided to study money.
Yep.
Biblical economics. Mm-hmm. And that was when I just came to the conclusion that, man, actually making a lot of money, if you're a good person, you make a lot of money, you can do a lot of good things. Mm-hmm. Money's just a tool. It's not good or bad. Mm. And I really was released from the guilt of making money. Mm-hmm. As long as you do it ethically and morally, as long as you hold it with open hands and a generous heart, then go make as much as you can. So that was when I finished Bible college. I just went really hardcore on the property stuff. But I also set up a little non-for-profit networking event for Christians, which was a Christian business network. Mm-hmm. And it was really for folks in my church or folks in other churches that felt misunderstood or judged. So I set this up, non-for-profit, and I went real hard on my property business. And I became a millionaire by age 25. Mm-hmm. And
was the majority of the money from these deals, like the leases?
A lot of it, yeah, a lot of it was. Because the market recovered, despite what the media said.
Yeah.
All the newspapers were saying, house prices are going to crash. They did crash, but then they bounced back up. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. So, you know, in 2010, 2011, mm-hmm. prices started rising. Yeah. From 2011 to 2016, oh my goodness, houses doubled in some areas.
Yeah.
So that first house that I bought in Birmingham, Merivale Road, that's now worth about 300,000.
And then did you get it transferred from Tim to your name?
Yes, okay. Of course, I still own it today.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Okay, so then when did you start to decide there's a lot of people that really want this information and start, let me do these courses?
Well, folks through my church and through this Christian business network started saying to me, can you teach me about money? How do you do? And I started asking me all these questions. And I, you know, I'll be like, yeah, sure. And, you know, I'd have them around for a coffee. And then this one day I just thought, you know what? I get so many questions now from, like, even my ex-school teachers and my friends.
Yeah, I saw that.
You've
helped your teacher out.
Yeah, 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 yeah. So many questions from people. I thought, you know what? I'm going to run a one-off training program.
Yep.
I'm going to book a hotel. And I'm just going to say, if you've got property questions, instead of asking me to come for coffee, I'm going to run a one-day training program.
Yep.
It's free. Come down and I'm going to share everything I know about property, condense it into one day.
Okay.
Called it the Property Investors Crash Course. Ran that program. I can't remember how many people were there, but a bunch of my friends
loads
and family.
Not even
loads, but just a handful of people came that I, you know, came down. And everyone was like, oh man, that was amazing. They started getting property deals, sharing the stories with me. When are you doing the next one? My friend wants to come. So I'm like, okay. So I put another one on, then another one on. And then I'm still running that same program today. And I'm getting like thousands and thousands. There's been over like 25,000 people that have attended now in person.
So then when did you start? Because it was free initially. When did you start charging?
So it's still free.
Okay.
It's still free. The Property Investors Crash Course is free. But what I found was those people that would say to me, I came on the training program. It was really good.
But what
I loved it. But I need a bit of mentorship. Can you look at this deal for me? Can you give me a bit of... So I thought, well, I need to... I can't just ignore these folks. Mm. But at the same time, I can't just continually teach for free. Mm-hmm. So at some point, and that was in 2016, October 2016, when I registered my property training company. Mm. And it just blew up.
Because that in itself... Because I know quite a few... they're called providers. And that in itself is a business model, even aside from you doing really well in property, making money or, you know, a business from providing courses as such. So did you have to study yourself, or did you have to do like a teaching qualification or anything? Or is it literally just what you've learned?
I mean, I have done quite a lot of, I mean, at Bible College, they taught me to preach.
So. And listen, do you know what? It's so funny because your name, unlike a lot of people I speak to, usually I speak to people that are really successful, but they're unknown. Mm. And your name has been around for a while, and I've always heard about it because I'm interested in property myself. And when I looked at your history, being in the church, I always, when you look at some of the most successful musicians, actors, public speakers, they all came from the church, because the church allowed you to have that sort of confidence to speak about various topics. Doesn't surprise me. When I hear you speak, I can hear, did you used to speak in church?
Yeah, I did, yeah. In fact, you know, I planned on going full-time into ministry after Bible college, and I just thought I'll probably end up, because we've got a lot of stuff that we do out, you know, in different parts of the world. My church sent me off to like India. I was working in Ludhiana. I've been to all different parts of the world, you know, preaching and doing different things and mission trips. So I didn't, it was until I did my dissertation in biblical economics and I thought, actually, you know what? I feel like I'm born. I feel like I'm on the planet to be an entrepreneur.
Yeah.
I feel like I've got an entrepreneurial gift.
But then theology is your only qualification.
I think in order to teach real estate or any business, I think you need to have walked it, been there, done it.
Agreed, yeah.
So I think that, yes, to run a training company, I think there's a lot of things that you need. I think, you know, you need to have insurance in place.
Yeah.
You need to have a complaints procedure.
Yeah.
You need to have you need to have proper contracts. You need to have, you know, like we've got all of our prices for all of our courses are all on the website, clearly transparent. But, you know, yes, it's important. Mm. But I think more than anything, if people are asking you to learn about real estate, you need to have done it.
Yeah.
And that's the biggest qualification that there is. I think it's just about actually having done it.
Yeah, because you're right. In terms of like being a mentor, you can gain more from having a really good mentor than sometimes studying. Mm. And sometimes those mentors are just about the lived experience. But I think when you're providing to many people, you don't necessarily need a teaching course, but sometimes people would be comfortable with people having a teaching course. But if you don't have one, your lived experience, I suppose, would suffice.
I think the biggest thing people ask me to prove, rather than like what qualifications do you have to teach, because I never went to university. Yeah. I failed in school.
Yeah,
I failed academically. Yeah. What people want to know more than anything is, who have you taught and what have they done?
Yeah.
What testimonials and references and success students do you have? I think that's generally what people want to know.
That's
what people ask me. And of course, I've written whole books with, you know, I've got hundreds and hundreds of people that can testify.
Over 100,000 copies you've sold, haven't you?
Yeah, 100,000 copies. But not just that, but I mean, every single week for the last 3 years, I've been doing an interview just like this, where I've been interviewing one of my students who's become financially free, who's, you know, maybe become a millionaire or quit their job, gone full time. I've been doing that every week for the last 3 years. Mm-hmm. So I think, for me, that's the thing I'm most proud of in terms of what qualifies me to teach and that I've actually done it myself.
Yeah, and I think the only reason why I'm asking is because I don't want to have any stone that's unturned. So when people watch this, it's not, when I spoke to you on the phone, it's not about the gotcha moments, it's about the questions that can be unearthed that you can answer. So people have confidence when they are watching you or gaining an understanding about what you do.
Another thing, I'm not being funny, but you can go, I know people that go to business university and they get a degree. It's backed by the government.
Yeah.
And they don't know jack about business.
Yeah, but I think, do you know what it is? I think when it comes to university, it's about how long it's been there. Or I think even in 2015, Trading Standards said that the universities had to fall under the Consumer Rights Act, which meant that if you are not happy with your degree after 2 weeks, you could actually get a full refund. So I think when it comes to certain courses, not just yours specifically, is that something that you provide? If someone has attended maybe a couple of your sessions or they feel it's not for them, as you said, it's important to have a complaints procedure. Do you have a cooling off period?
Yeah, we don't say at the end of the year, if you've not been successful, you can get a refund.
Yeah, of course, not at the end of the year.
But I don't know, are you sure do unions really do that?
Yeah, they have to.
So when you get the degree and you finish, I'm not happy.
So let's say, for example, I enroll
and
I've got my student finance or what have you. There was loads of complaints. And in 2015, they said that universities do have to fall under the Consumer Rights Act.
If they've not delivered.
Consumer Rights Act. No. So that's why I said 2 weeks. So if they've gone to all their lectures, so the benchmark is 2 weeks, but some universities have said that they do it for longer.
2 weeks after they sign up or after they've done the program?
After they've signed up. After 2 weeks of having your whole degree.
I was going to say, like, I'm thinking that's correct. Because you know what? If you did do that, though, imagine if you said to someone, if it does, because sometimes people say to me, oh, if it doesn't work out, I'm not successful, can I have my money back?
But the thing is,
if I say yes, you won't be successful because there's no skin in the game.
They have to apply themselves.
Exactly.
And that's why I said at the beginning, you can't say, I disagree. When someone has even said to me, oh, you're a scammer, when you look at the word scam, it's attached to the word fraud, and fraud is illegal, and you would be in prison right now, or you would have endless court cases.
Right, and we would lose.
There we go. So I'm very cautious to call anyone a scammer. That's not really my question. My question.
Yeah, all of our contracts. Of course, if someone registers for a program,
you
know, all of our contracts are legally drawn up and they're proper. Sometimes we have calling off periods. I think it depends on where and when they register. I don't know, I can't remember off the top of my head what the laws are, but we have lawyers, in-house lawyers that work with us to make sure that we are not only running legally, we have third-party independent companies that come check us out. Yeah. We regularly do audits. So, and I think, that's important.
And I think it's good that you say that, because that's what people look for. And like you've said before, it can take one person. Like, no shade on him, but I watched the conversation with you and Poku Banks. And I just thought, you know what? You're a better man than me, because it was just so trivial in terms of him trying to have those got you moments, as opposed to it being a positive, okay, so can you explain this, how I'm saying, okay.
Yeah, but that really hurt him, that ruined him, you know, because he came across dumb, you know, so.
But again, he's not here to defend himself. But my point was, I would never try and say, you're this, you're that.
Yeah, anyone that does, though, comes across dumb.
Yeah, of course. But it's, as you know, it's more about educating and peace of mind.
Yeah, yeah, I agree.
So now you're saying that your courses have structure, they have contractual agreements, they have cooling off or complaints procedure.
Yeah, of course.
When people say, you know, he's selling this course for too much money, or my thing is this, from a consumer point of view, we can say anything's too much money. I can say, my iPhone's not worth over $1,000.
Yeah.
But then whose responsibility is that on? Is that on me, or is that on the person who decided to make the iPhone? Does that make sense?
Yeah, it's all businesses. You need a willing seller and a willing buyer.
Yeah.
You know.
The only thing that, in terms of marketing, is, and I'm interested to hear what your views are on this, when people say, and this was before I even heard of you, when people say, like, I've seen books financially free, me personally, because I read a lot of philosophy, I don't think there is any such thing as financially free. And I think it's a good way to package things, because if you actually look at the term financially free, it's Googled over 33 million times, which means people are very desperate to look for the quickest route from A to B, which would be financially free. So when you say you help people to be financially free, what do you mean by financially free?
Yeah, that's a great question, because it does mean different things to different people.
Yeah.
I mean, to me, financially free means that if you've got a passive income, that's, i.e. you don't have to work for it.
Okay.
That covers your living expenses.
Okay.
That's our definition of financially free. But I guess it means different things to different people. And you might have somebody who's a doctor who's making £10,000 a month. And for them to be financially free, it's very different to somebody who's got a much more simple life, who might be single, with no kids. Mm-hmm. So it is a different figure for different people.
Yeah.
That's interesting. 33 million times.
Wow. That was the last time I looked at it.
Yeah.
So you can see how, I don't want to call it a buzz term, a buzzword, but I think oftentimes the people that I've spoken to, and who I think you're brilliant for, and I know you're brilliant for loads of people, but are people that may have some capital. Mm. And that's why I wanted to get more into how people with no capital, no money, can really benefit off of the things that you advise. Because when I've spoken to well-known musicians and footballers that you've helped massively, it's like, okay, but you've kind of got the money. So you happen to lose that money, you're still okay.
Yeah.
But for the person who, the average person on the internet that's really desperate, and we see all of these, I'm a property investor, what does that actually mean? How can that person go from, I'm going to keep it 100, I make 1,500 a month from my job in JD Sports, I've looked at Samuel Leeds, what is my next move to try and get involved in property? What would you say to that person?
I think that's a really good question. So what we teach on the training is that there's two types of income that you can make from property.
Okay.
There's fast pound and there's slow pound. Mm-hmm. There's active income and there's passive income. So if I'm coaching a footballer, or if I'm coaching someone, even a business person, someone that's already making good money, they're making money, they've got fast pound coming in already, mm-hmm. I'm going to teach them strategies where they can invest the money that they're making, and they can invest it in property, mm-hmm. which is going to give them a slow, consistent, passive income. Mm-hmm. Fast pound is if someone comes to me and they go, I hate my job, I want to get out. I'm working at JD Sports.
Yep.
I'm spending 40 hours a week.
And there's nothing wrong with working at JD Sports.
There's nothing wrong with it. Yeah. But if someone doesn't like it and they're making £1,500, yep, I can say, well, hang on, you could make that a week, mm-hmm, by literally packaging property investments, not buying them, but passing them on to investors and charging a finder's fee. That's called fast pound. That's called active income. It's not passive. It's not going to make you financially free. But you can make money in property and you can invest money in property.
Can you tell me what that looks like? So from day one, my education is quite low. I don't know anything about property.
Yeah.
So I want to leave my job in a month.
Okay.
So what does this packaging of deals look like? What's my first step?
Okay. First step, when you wake up in the morning, instead of going on Instagram and scrolling through, go on Rightmove.
Okay.
Go look at all the properties that have come on. Look at the oldest listed properties. Look at the agents. Look on the on these apps and softwares where you can see properties. Mm-hmm. Anything that looks interesting or juicy, save it.
What's juicy? What would be
a... What would be juicy would be maybe something that's got potential to be developed, or maybe something that's potentially could be rented out on a room by room basis.
Okay.
Or maybe something that looks like, you know, it could be a discounted property because they're motivated to sell it. In the description, it says motivated seller.
Anything so for
that,
sale, look
yes.
At, okay, yeah.
Anything that looks at all juicy,
okay,
even a little bit juicy,
mm-hmm,
just save it.
Okay.
Click a little heart on the right move and then move on with your day. Then when you're at lunch, mm-hmm, in JD Sports, pick up the phone and phone everyone that you saved and say, hey, my name's whatever, mm-hmm, can I book a viewing on this property? Spend one day every other week. Put a day aside and just bang, 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 and spend the whole day property shopping.
Mm-hmm.
Go out there and view 10 houses.
Mm-hmm.
You can do it on top of your job. When you view these 10 houses, negotiate, talk to the sellers. One of those houses is going to be a juicy deal. If it's nice and if you think you can get a good price on it and if it looks attractive to an investor, at the same time as doing this, go to one property networking event a month and ask people at the event, what are you looking to invest in at the moment? If I can find something that might fit that criteria, would you be willing to pay me a finder's fee? What's your email and I'll keep you on my list in the evenings. And if you can, it might be a little bit hard. It might take you a month or it might take you 2 months. Mm. But if you can sell that one deal to an investor and make a £3,000 finder's fee, I found a house that's 150 grand and I've negotiated to buy it for 110. That's a 40 grand saving. All I want is £3,000 as a finder's fee. How would you like to pay? If you can do that once a month,
mm-hmm,
then you're going to be replacing the average salary.
Okay, I've got a question to ask you. Let's say, for example, the person realizes I'm quite young or I'm inexperienced.
Mm.
What's to stop them, once I've found them the deal, of cutting me out?
They can't because they're going to sign a non-disclosure agreement.
Okay, so this is what I need to get them to do. So once that person, I've gone to the networking event.
And they say they're interested.
They're interested.
You're going to say, great. What's going to happen now is I'm going to give you a non-disclosure agreement.
Yep.
Sign that. Mm-hmm. Then I'm going to give you all the property information. And you've got 24 hours to do your due diligence and research. If you then want to go ahead, you're going to pay me my money, £3,000. You're then going to have a 14-day calling off period.
Okay.
Where you're then going to be able to view the property, do all your research. And if you're still happy, then boom, money's mine. Any issues, I'll refund you.
And who pays for the surveyor and all of that?
Would the
that
investor.
Be... Okay, so they just do, all I'm doing is connecting
Introducing.
The deal and the property
Correct.
Investor.
Yes.
Okay. So let's get on to quickly rent to rent.
Yeah.
Because I see so many people now saying I'm a property investor via rent to rent.
Yeah.
But I had a conversation about this a while ago and I did have some concerns about how a lot of people are making it sound so easy. What's your advice around rent to rent? Because one of the red flags for me is not a lot of these people, what they're doing is they're asking for angel investors.
Right.
And they're saying, invest in my rent to rent project and I will give you the return. But they're not talking about, or they're advising people to do rent to rent, but they're not talking about, okay, you need an HMO license.
Mm.
They're not talking about if you take this property off of the owner, you have to now make sure that there's regulatory things within the property, like every door has to be fire regged and all the rest of it. I'm not seeing those conversations. Do you see what I mean? Or for example, how do you pay for the void period?
Yeah.
So let's say you've done your rent to rent on each room and someone leaves and you can't fill that one room.
Yeah.
Do you see what I mean? Like all
100%.
all these conversations, they're not happening. Why do people make rent to rent sound so easy when it actually isn't?
I think number one, That's why I believe there's a gap for good training.
Okay. Do you train all the...
Oh, yeah.
Again, maybe you need to come along one day, but do you actually go through the process of...
Like, in absolute A to Z in great detail. All the things you talked about, fire drill, everything you've spoken about is all part of a rent-to-rent training program.
Yeah.
So first thing is, I think that, you need training. Second thing I'd say is rent-to-rent's a business. It's a business.
Yeah.
You know, you're not investing in property.
Yeah, you're not a property investor if you do rent-to-rent, are you?
No, you're a property entrepreneur.
Yeah, once you've done a few successful projects.
Yeah.
Yeah, because again, there are people, I'm not in the game of naming names, but there's people online at the moment that are saying that they're property entrepreneurs.
They're entrepreneurs.
Entrepreneurs.
That's what they should be.
Property entrepreneur.
Yeah.
Love that. I'm going to use that word.
Yeah, and there's nothing wrong with being a property entrepreneur.
Nothing wrong with it.
How do you get from a entrepreneur to an entrepreneur? You get trained. You find a mentor. You actually go out and do it. And I think that, you know, rent-to-rent's a business.
Yeah.
So, you know, you've got to learn the process. You've got to understand the area. You've got to understand the rules. You've got to understand the risks. You've got to understand if you're taking money off someone, if you're borrowing money off someone to put into a rent-to-rent.
Yeah.
I see it as well. It's like blind leading the blind.
Yeah.
You know, people are like, I don't know what I'm doing, but I'll have a bash because I watched a YouTube video.
Yeah.
And I'll, you know, and I'll borrow my auntie's money and promise her, but then that's just bad business.
Yeah.
If you're starting any business, if you're starting, you know, a fashion business, or if you're starting a restaurant business, you've got to understand the business.
Yeah.
And you can, you know, you can figure it out by trial and error, make mistakes, or you can go along to a training program and you can find someone that's done it. Mm-hmm. But I think, you know, ultimately rent to rent, is it easy or is it hard? I guess it depends on, everyone asks me that, they're like, is this going to be easy or is it hard? And I'll say, well, if you're asking me if it's going to be easy or is it hard, you're probably not the right person.
100%.
Because everything's hard.
And takes work.
No, but everything does. Having a job's hard.
Yeah.
Having a business is hard.
Mm-hmm.
Being rich is hard.
Mm-hmm.
Being poor is also hard. Being fat's hard. But so is having a six pack, right? So everything's hard. So which hard are you going to choose? Mm. So I think if, you know, someone thinks rent to rents is, you know, oh, it's going to be really easy. Well, everything's hard. It's just about what kind of hard you want to choose. Do you want to choose JD? Sports for 40 years?
Would you advise someone doing a rent-to-rent when they have absolutely no capital? So again, going back to, I don't expect you to share all your juicy secrets that you get on your training course with regards to rent-to-rent.
Yeah.
But would you advise someone who doesn't have, or even would you advise an angel investor to invest in somebody doing rent-to-rent that's had no experience or doesn't have any capital, or any properties themselves, that if things go tits up...
Yeah, I wouldn't advise investing in anything unless you know the subject. So if you're investing in a rent-to-rent, if you're aware of the risk and you're aware of the investment and you understand rent-to-rents and you want to put your money into a newbie that's starting out, then fine. But if you don't know what you're doing and you don't know, then you shouldn't invest in it. And in terms of should you start rent-to-rents if you've got no capital, it depends on the person. It depends on their appetite for risk.
Yeah.
It depends on... I mean, if you don't want any risk whatsoever, then you shouldn't be in business.
100%, yeah.
So there's always risk. Mm. In fact, there's probably more risk having a job, let's face it, because you can get made redundant. Everything comes with risk. Mm. Life is risky. None of us are going to make it out alive.
Mm. Oh, do you want to touch wood somewhere?
No, but it's true, right? We're all going to die.
Yeah, eventually.
So we're not going to make it out alive.
Yeah.
So everything's got risk. Yeah. So it's just a case of, let me educate myself and take the best, that, you know, and a job, usually speaking, is when someone pays you just enough to not go and take that risk. I'll pay you just enough.
Mm.
And it's like, okay. And if you're going to ask me, what should someone do? Should someone do rent to rent? Should someone have a job? Depends on the person.
Yeah.
Some people should have a job. Some people should have a business.
I think it's important to know yourself as well. And there is an obsession in this day and age. I want to be an entrepreneur. I want to be. And they think it's all fun and games. And sometimes, oftentimes, that's harder.
Mm. Yeah.
And it's just because it is the fashion to say I am an entrepreneur.
It wasn't when I started.
Yeah.
It was the opposite.
Go and get a job.
It wasn't, no, but it wasn't cool.
Yeah.
Now it's kind of cool to be an entrepreneur.
Yeah.
But 12, 13 years ago, that wasn't the case. There wasn't people on Instagram and making it cool, talking about business.
Yeah.
But I don't think that's necessarily a bad thing. If people are like, oh man, I want to be an entrepreneur. Mm. And even financially free. If someone says, I want to be financially free, is that a bad thing? I don't think it's a bad thing. I think it's just a case of, listen, if you're prepared to put the work in and you understand what, you know, then, you know, I guess I don't necessarily think it's a bad thing.
And then what about, because I know quite a few people that are involved in property suggest if you don't have the money, then, you know, raise the capital from other people who can't be bothered to look for property, buy it at under market value. But then again, I don't hear of a conversation where it's important that you're FCA regulated. So with all those things again, you discussed this in your course.
You don't need to be FCA regulated to borrow money off somebody.
Not to borrow money from a personal, but let's say, for example, if I wanted to buy a property and I'm going to angel investors, or depending on the amount, if it's seen as a retail amount, for me to take multiple amounts of money from people, you do need to be FCA regulated.
Yeah, so we have a training program on raising finance where we talk about the rules. You need to be FCA regulated if you're advertising and you're saying what the returns are. So if I was running an advert saying I'm offering 10% returns and I was doing this as an ad, posting it.
As a unilateral deal, contract.
Right, or just putting the number, even if I post it on social media.
Yeah.
Hey, if I put a post on social media and say, I want 100 grand and I'm offering a 10% return, that would be illegal. If I put a post on social media and say, I'm looking for 100 grand, if you're interested, message me, let's have a conversation. That's not. So it's important to know the rules, for sure, and the risks.
Do you ever, and this is not just with your courses, but people that just want to have some advice, do you ever turn people away and say, do you know what, you've told me your financial circumstances, or I do think you need to go away and have a look, and like you said yourself, you read extensively and went to courses first. Before people want to say, let's say someone who said, I've saved up really hard for 2 grand. And do you ever say, listen, go away and learn a bit more before you come over?
Yeah, that's a great question. So yes and no. So we do tell people not to invest in courses that they can't afford. At every training program I ever run.
Okay.
We also tell people, look, very clearly, at every single training program we run, we say, if ever we're offering further training, that is, we say, this is a process, not a promise.
Okay.
It's an opportunity, not a guarantee. Mm-hmm. So we make it very clear, and we tell people don't invest in any courses that you can't afford. However,
I respect that, yeah.
However, we don't turn people away.
Yeah.
Because how can we? If someone comes to me and says, of course, if they can't afford it, they can't afford it. If someone comes to me and says, I want to do the training, I've got the money, here's the £500, £100, whatever it might be for the particular course, I want to do the training, and they've got the money. Who are we to say, nah, you're not right fit?
Yeah.
You know? Mm. Imagine when I started out when I was 17 years old and I had my £3,000 from my paper and money. If I'd have gone to that event and they're all wearing suits and I'm feeling out of place and I'm like, oh man, I've got my paper and money. And they'd have gone, nah, come back in 5 years when you've grown up. That would have ruined me.
Yeah, of course.
The fact that they believed me and took me seriously and were like, yeah, you can't. So we don't turn people away in terms of if they've got the money and they want to invest, we tell them the risk, but we don't tell them, no, you can't. We don't discriminate.
Yeah, you make it clear.
Yeah.
You make sure you can afford this. And then like I said before, I do think when I have heard negativity around you, I say, hang on a minute, whoa. The whole concept of criticizing you for maybe hard selling or what is unethical, or you know, people have found themselves in debt. And like I said before, you can say that about anything in life.
Yeah.
You can say that about an 18-year-old that wants a Dior jacket for however many grands, or trainers for £980. Do you see what I mean?
Yeah.
Those big companies that we never criticize are never criticised by saying, did you ask that 18-year-old if he can afford it before he bought those trainers? Do you see what I mean?
You can't though, really. I mean,
but that's what I mean. I think there is a big issue, like you said, here in Britain, I think there is a big issue with a hate for capitalism. And I always am very open to say, I appreciate and support capitalism because I think everything is based on capitalism. I don't believe in not having any socialism tendencies.
Right.
You need that to support society.
Yeah.
But going back to what we said earlier about landlords, there's always hate oftentimes for landlords, you know, capitalist landlords.
Mm.
But then when it comes to the tenants, there's all this support.
I think it's just a case of if you're making money and if you're in business, it's just about you have to have a moral responsibility to, you know, like even if you're making a lot of money, you have I'm a capitalist, but I believe in compassionate capitalism.
What is compassionate capitalism?
So basically, a lot of socialists or even communists, even though I might disagree with their arguments. And I've tried many times to sit down and have a debate with a communist, and they never will. But I actually feel like if I chatted with a communist, our heart might be in the right place. Because their heart often, or socialists, is I just want equal opportunity and I want people to be able to, you know, I feel like all the money should be given to the government and then they can distribute it fairly and then everything's equal and everything's... And I can kind of understand where they're coming from, but the problem is it just doesn't work. And every time it's ever happened, it's devastated the country because it's almost like, well, firstly, the government don't distribute it fairly. We all know it. They just, you know, it gets in the hands of the wrong people. And secondly, it kills entrepreneurs because imagine if you said to a group of school kids, we're going to add up all your school grades and then we're going to divide them. No one would try. So capitalism, I agree with you, capitalism actually brings value and it's a good thing, but then I think...
And healthy competition.
Right, yeah, it makes things better.
You can't call yourself entrepreneur or I want to be a millionaire and say you don't agree with capitalism.
No, you can't. But the thing is, what I do believe in though is, so communism says, let's give all the money to the government and let them distribute it.
Yeah.
I believe, no, the money belongs in the hands of the people, but I think that people have an obligation to help other people that are suffering, you know? Mm. So if you're making money, like me, right, I'm making a lot of money. But we do a lot of good work with that money. You know, I have the Samuel Leeds Foundation, which we sew into.
Yeah, we're building a school as well in Uganda.
We're building a school in Uganda. Mm. We do a lot to help people that are less fortunate. And yeah. I think that if you're going to be successful, if you're going to make a lot of money, at least help other people and at least pull people up with you.
Yeah. But then I also think as well, I wouldn't say it's a problem, but I really appreciate business individuals who are happy to look as though they don't come across as perfect and altruistic and yeah. let's hold hands and I'm here to help, because that's not the facts of life. Does yeah. that make sense?
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
That's not the facts of life. And two things I really respect about entrepreneurs or millionaires or whatever is, yeah, okay, my style in terms of selling or whatever, it may be slightly harsh sometimes, and this is not to you, I'm just saying. Mm. Or, you know, yes, I've set out to make money, but now I've made money, I can help people.
Yeah.
Whereas sometimes if someone just acts like everything's perfect and it's only to help people, it's not believable.
Yeah, no, it's authentic. It's got to be authentic and real. You know? You're talking about people, it's like a facade. If they're if you to be very successful in business, you have to be a bit hard sometimes.
Yeah.
You know, you have to be a bit hard sometimes. But I think that what I'm talking about is more a case of having a responsibility to help other people. You know,
yeah.
I believe that. I believe yeah. the very reason I got into business in the first place was to not just make a load of money, but to impact people. I think money can make things happen.
Yeah.
You know, so.
Yeah. And I think it's amazing what you're doing. And I think also, I want to give you a bit of advice. I think you should just stop answering the trolls. I know it's...
I love answering the trolls.
No,
though.
I think... Do you know what it does?
Don't take this from me.
It's detracting away from the good that you're doing.
Yeah, yeah.
And it's almost like, you know when a boyfriend cheats?
Mm, I've not had that, but yeah.
Yeah. I'm sure you've known people around you. Or a girlfriend.
Yeah.
Not that you're saying your missus cheats. But, and they're trying to overprove. I haven't. You're going to start believing you have because you're doing too much now.
Mm.
So I think with you, there comes a point where one thing I do love is you're actually in the process of suing people.
Yeah.
And that is important.
I've been compensated already.
Yeah. And was that to do with the attachment to the soldier who committed suicide? What the BBC said.
It's all linked, you know. Yeah. And this is really important as well, because you say about not responding to the trolls. I didn't used to, but what I realised is, and as a result of not responding to allegations and criticisms and trolls, I used to think, you know what, I've got nothing to prove. I'm just going to let my results speak for themselves. And when the BBC put that disgusting show out, you know, which is just like, when I saw that, I was just like, I couldn't believe.
Yeah.
I mean, it was a little shitty regional show anyway. It wasn't like a mainstream, but I was just like, I can't believe they've linked, like, some, you know, the story. Someone committed suicide and then they said, oh, but he did it after going on Samuel's course.
They tried to attach it.
I'm just like, what?
Yeah. And the Telegraph actually said there's no causal link.
Right. Yeah. I mean, of course there isn't.
Yeah.
You know, on the guy's inquest, there's just zero link.
Yeah.
But that's not what's out. It's the headline.
Yeah, of course.
You know, oh, the person takes his life after going on Samuel Lee's course. well, what does that mean? Yeah. You're trying to say, I like. So at the time, I remember just thinking, people are intelligent. People aren't stupid. I'm just going to just ignore it.
I think there's more unintelligent people than there are intelligent.
Well, I just thought, I'm going to ignore it.
Yeah.
I'm not going to talk about it.
Yeah.
I'll obviously put, you know, I did address it.
Yeah.
How devastated I was with the, you know, the guy that took his life. But I thought, I'm not going back and forth with the trolls and all this. I'm just going to leave it. And I just cracked on with my business. But the thing is, what I realized is, because I wasn't addressing all these trolls that were coming after me, mm-hmm. if you don't put the facts on the table, people just make stuff up.
Yeah, but then do you not think that, from my own experience, on a very low level, that once you start to bite, it's like, oh, we've got him, we're rattling him, and it will continue and continue to the point where now, when I want to search for you, I want to search for the good that you can advise me or how I can make money instead of I respond to troll, I do this, I do that. And I think it does take away a little bit of all of the success that you're now doing.
Listen, I mean, I don't sit every day responding to every comment, right? Yeah, yeah. But if there's an allegation out there,
you're gonna address
about
it.
Me, you know, which there was.
Yeah.
There was allegations and people were talking and people were saying a lot of stuff. I feel like I felt like I had an obligation and a duty to my customers,
yeah,
to my family, mm-hmm. to my staff, to people that know. I have an obligation to go, hey, this is actually the truth of the matter.
Yeah.
And, you know, I didn't want to have to sue people.
Yeah.
I don't enjoy suing people.
I think you should, sorry.
No, but I didn't want to do that. But I just thought, you know what? The people that have harassed me and my staff and my customers and my family,
yeah.
and have tried to damage and tried to cut, you know, I felt like I had an obligation to my family and my staff and that to just say, actually, no, enough's enough. And that's why I don't spend a super long time responding to trolls now, but that's why I just, when we went into lockdown, you know, like almost a couple of years ago now, that was when I put a little series out, bang, 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 bang.
Yeah, one, yeah.
I did like 6 or 7 videos and then, you know, decided to take legal action. And I'm glad that I did. And at the time, a lot of people said, because it had been like 6 months since all the bad press, a lot of people reached out to me and said, thank you for doing that. Because my mom or my wife or this was asking me all about it and I didn't know what to say.
Yeah.
So at least now I have something to show them.
Yeah, I think it's important. I think a lot of people think that they can get away with things as well. And what legal route did you go down? Was it defamation?
Defamation and harassment.
Yeah. And then just because people are so curious, what was the whole thing with Alan Sugar? You did sit down with him. I think, did he come out and say, I don't know this guy?
Yeah, he did.
That was a bit cheeky.
Yeah, it was. So my friend Sugar. I had a business roundtable session with Lord Sugar.
And you paid for that, didn't you?
I paid for it, about £5,000.
And I have to interject there. That is so interesting because a lot of people, I think, also are up themselves. And even though you were already successful, you saw the benefit of sitting with someone who is hugely successful as Alan Sugar.
Yeah.
And you thought, I'm going to invest in myself by paying $5,000 to sit with Alan Sugar.
Yeah, that was cheap.
Yeah.
I was pleased.
And why did you pay £5,000 to talk to Alan Sugar? What did you think you were going to get from him that you couldn't look online?
Because he's making more money than I am. So, of course, I'm going to sit with him. I'm going to say, come on. Come on, brother. Help a man out, man.
Yeah.
You're making more money than me. What am I doing
wrong? So that means you're not financially free yet.
No, it's not that I'm not financially free. It's that I want to be the best version of myself.
Of course, yeah.
I'm always wanting to improve.
Yeah.
And the second you say, actually, people sometimes say, when's enough going to be enough? The moment you say enough is enough now, then what's the purpose of life anymore?
When it's funny because that same philosopher that I read a lot about, he said, you're financially free when you realise what contentment and enough is.
Right.
That's true financial freedom.
Right, yeah.
Not continuing to make loads of passive income.
Yeah.
So then going back to Lord Sugar, so then what made him actually do a video to say, I don't know this guy?
Oh, I don't know,
Was it the bad press? He got scared.
I have no idea. I've never sat down with him and asked him the question, but I just did a funny response video.
Kept it moving.
No, I just said, hey, I said, apparently me and Lord Sugar don't know each other. I never sat down with him. I've never had any business advice from him. Here's the invoice. Here's the photos. Oh, and actually, I've put together a manual with everything I learned from Lord Sugar. I paid £5,000. I've put it in a manual. You can have it for free. I'll leave it in the description. Just put the coupon Sugar. I got like 5,000 people give me their email address in exchange. So it's like, even if people are going after you, you can't take it too seriously.
Yeah.
Like, for me, I was surprised when I saw him saying, he said, I haven't advised him on business. I've never given him any business advice. And I'm like, dude, I got the receipts, bro.
Yeah, yeah.
Like, always keep receipts.
That's so cheeky. So now, just before I let you go, because it's been such a good chat, how many actual properties do you own yourself? Because I've got this amount. I know you're about controlling, not necessarily ownership.
Yeah, yeah.
But I've got this in my head, how many I want to own. So
you
I want to know how many you own yourself.
So I don't really buy properties and accumulate them now. I'm developing houses.
Okay.
So I build and sell. And so it's you know, I've been involved in over 400 property transactions.
Mm. No, but you yourself. On land registry, if I put your name, how many?
The thing is, I used to talk about it and say, this is how many. Every year I used to say, this is what I've bought, this is what I own.
Yeah.
But the number keeps changing.
Okay, yeah.
Because every month I'll have sold some, I'll have developed some.
Give me a range, average.
But the thing is, I made the decision that actually, you know what? I'm not going to give people numbers because then people will try and catch me out. And, oh, you said this in this interview and then this. But it's like,
do you think?
It changes. Oh, yeah.
I don't know, though. You know what?
Another thing is this. Like, for instance, my castle that I own.
Okay.
Right?
Why do you own a castle?
Because I bought it to develop it.
And do what with it?
Then sell it. That's what I do. I buy and build and sell.
What sort of person would buy a castle?
Someone crazy like me. No, but the thing is, how many properties is that? Is that one? Or is that 17?
Because you might convert it.
Well, no, I already have.
Into how many flats?
I've got planning permission now. It's split up. I've got planning permission to be 13 apartments and 4 houses.
Wow.
So does that count as one or does it count as 17?
It's a project, isn't it?
Yeah, but how many houses is it?
It depends when they become the actual physical houses and flats.
But it's already got planning permission.
They're not there yet, though.
No, they are.
What, you physically built them?
No, we've just split them.
Okay.
So we've split them up.
Okay, so you've got the dividing walls.
Yeah.
Have they each got a toilet and a kitchenette?
Yeah. Yeah.
Then they're the amount, then.
Well, how many is it? Is it one or is it 17?
17.
Is it?
Yeah.
But it's you see,
so
it's
you've
not
already given me, you've got 17.
Oh man, I've got a lot more than that.
Okay, there you go. That's good enough. You've got more than 17 properties.
A lot more than that, I can assure you.
And is that, do you do that under a limited company or do you do that in your name?
So I used to buy in my own name until 2016, 2017, when they changed the rules. They brought in Section 24.
Yeah, which came into fruition in 2020.
Yes, it did indeed.
Yeah.
So now if I'm buying, I don't really buy properties anymore. I don't really invest in properties.
You just control them.
No, I don't even control them. Oh. I'm a property developer.
Oh,
so my whole thing now is, like I've got eight sites at the moment.
Yeah.
I'm trying to get planning permission on a lot of them and it's a painful process, but like that.
Do you have to give a percentage to social housing?
Because it depends on the size of them. Isn't it? It depends on the area and the size and you obviously pay like tax and stuff. But like, my strategy, what I'm moving into now, is buy land, get planning permission, and then sell the land and profit from the planning. That's what I've been doing for the last 2-3 years.
Yeah.
So that's kind of like, I'm more thinking about the money than trying to monopolize. I don't know. This is what Lord Sugar taught me in 2017. Because I said, when I met Lord Sugar, I'll tell you how many houses I owned when I met Lord Sugar. I had 96 houses.
You had how many?
96.
In your name?
Yes.
96 houses in your name?
Yes.
And then what happened?
My goal was to get to 1,000. Okay. And Lord Sugar told me it was a stupid plan. He said, how many billionaires do you know that have got 1,000 residential houses?
Why did you want 1,000?
Ego.
Yeah.
That's why I don't want to get hung up now on like, oh, I own this many houses.
Yeah.
It's not about that.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Mm. For me, it's not about that. Lord Sugar told me to get into bigger deals and commercial. Grant Cardone started mentoring me. I paid him £200,000.
You paid him what?
£200,000.
And how long does this mentorship go on for?
No, it's just a few coffees.
Wow. And that's why you can't understand when people say, why should his course be 12,000? Because you're out here investing in yourself by paying people to learn more.
And I don't have a course that's 12,000.
It's the accumulation of multiple courses.
And not even that. It's not even that. It's a 12-month one-on-one mentorship program.
With you?
Me and my team.
Oh, okay. How many of the sessions are just with you, though?
Unlimited. Oh, with me? So they spend 2 days with me.
Out of the 12 months?
Yeah, my house.
Oh, okay.
And they also have unlimited access to mentors, which is sometimes with me, but I can't promise me. I might be busy.
Yeah.
We've got a team. There's about seven of us.
Okay.
So it's like, when people say 12 grand for a course, it's like, actually, our training company provides the best value for our training, our mentoring, than any other in the country.
And do they get an accreditation once they... Okay, it's just literally the knowledge.
Yeah.
Okay. So, as you know, this is the point where I say, are you willing to have someone shadow you? But I'm going to give you two options.
Okay.
Someone to shadow you for, let's say, a month.
Okay.
Or someone to have your course for 50% discount for the 12 months. What would you rather?
Oh, man. I think they'd probably get more value. If it's the 12-month unlimited, I'd probably get more value from that.
At half price?
Yeah, I can do that. I'll do one better. I'll do a 90% discount.
90% discount. Yeah. Brilliant.
Yeah.
For the 12-month course.
Yeah.
And that's with the mentorship and everything.
Correct.
Okay,
everything.
I'm gonna screen and send you the top 10 and you can choose from that person.
All right, let's do it.
Well, thanks for coming.
Welcome, thanks.